Hi, welcome to Weld.com. I'm Beau Wigington, and I hear you're interested in welding school. Let's talk about it. A little bit about me. I had no experience welding, so I decided it was probably a good idea for me to go to school. And I enrolled in GTCC, our local community college here in Greensboro, North Carolina. I took an intro to welding course, which we touched on stick, MIG, a little bit of cutting, and after I finished that, I was hooked, so I signed up for their certificate program. And after I completed that, I still wanted more welding, so I took their TIG pipe and certification practices, and here I am today, in love with welding. And let me share a little bit of what the experience of going to school is like. So one thing you need to be prepared for is you're going to have to get tools and personal protective equipment. Sometimes your school will provide that for you, or they'll have an option of a bundle you can buy, or you can get it by yourself. Some of the tools that you're going to be needing, depending on what program you're going into, it's all going to vary, but these are some pretty important tools to have. First, this is going to be your best friend. When trying to learn, you're going to have to clean your welds. That is one thing in welding that's very important, is keeping your welds clean, especially after multiple passes. You need to make sure there's not going to be inclusions. So this is a wire brush. And then, usually you're starting off in stick. This is going to be your other best friend, and it is a chipping hammer. This is what you're going to use to remove slag from your welds. These are some lineman pliers. There's pretty heavy duty cutting pliers, and when you are doing stick welding or TIG welding, you have some thick electrodes or wire that you're going to want to cut through. You want to be able to pick up your metal, you want to clamp it down. There's a lot of things that you'll be doing with these. These are called C-clamps, and you will use them all the time. So you want to make sure you get some that you'll be able to adjust while it's closed so you can get the right size. Another tool that is very important, especially if you're going into MIG welding, these are welpers. These are going to be used for clipping your wire. You have a spot here for taking on and off your contact tip. You can adjust your nozzle. You clean out your nozzle with these. There's just a lot that you're going to be doing with this one pair of pliers. So you want to have a crescent wrench. This is going to be very important for adjusting fixtures. When you're setting up your machine, you're going to be using this to tighten down things. We got a couple bonus tools. This is going to be one of your best friends, especially if you are trying to go and do a lot of things without carrying a lot of tools. A file is going to be a big help to you. Soapstone. Sometimes your program will give you some, but if not, it's not that expensive. You'll be able to write on metal with this and it won't be a permanent mark. So speaking of tools you're going to use a lot, probably the tool you're going to use more than any other tool is going to be a grinder. So this is going to be used for cleaning your material. When you're getting it ready to weld, you're going to use this to just grind down surfaces. This is the guard. You want to make sure you keep the guard on, because these can shoot off like bullets, and this could save your life. But it also directs the sparks to go in a specific way. Last tool, Beau's bonus, as you might say. This was given to me by one of my instructors, and it was a huge help. This is a nifty little tool that you can get into the toes of your weld, especially if you're stick welding. Trying to clean out the toes can be very difficult, so this was a big help. Anywhere you can find just pieces of bandsaw blade, it will help you, I promise. Alright, so now that we've covered our tools, let's cover the things that are going to be protecting your body. That's our personal protective equipment. Probably the most important piece of your equipment is going to be a pair of these, safety glasses. You're going to want to make sure you have these on at all times, because they protect your eyes from UV rays, but they also protect your eyes from flying debris. Another really good thing to have is going to be ear protection. Not a lot of people know how much damage sound over time can do to you. So a grinder running all day is going to do more damage to your ears than a gunshot right next to your head. These are some isotunes. They're OSHA approved. You can listen to things at a reasonable level, but you want to make sure you have something in your ears, because not only can the sound hurt you, you can also get a spark in your ear, and when that goes down in your ear canal and burns around, it is not a good time. Another really important part is one of these, a welding cap. This is going to protect your head from flying sparks and beads. And it will soak up the sweat as well, because trust me, you're going to get nice and sweaty doing this. This was my first welding cap, and as you can see, it's gotten a lot of use. These are Como caps, great welding hats. You can find them at your local welding supply store. You can order them online. Just a really good thing to pick up. There's lots of different styles, so check them out. What's going to be important to protect? Well, my body. So on the bottom side of my body, I'm going to want to have a pair of denim pants or wool pants. Wool pants are a little hot for me, but you want to have something that is not going to be synthetic. Because if it's synthetic, it can melt to your leg. That's not so much fun. And as far as the top side of your body, depending on what process you're going to be doing, if you're doing stick, there's a lot of sparks flying. This is a leather jacket, and it will protect you, but it is very hot. And so say you're doing something that's not quite as intense like TIG. If you have a long sleeve shirt like this, it'll protect you from those UV rays. Another thing, if you're doing, let's say MIG, and you're wearing a long sleeve shirt, you want to protect your arms. These are a pair of welding sleeves. They're just leather sleeves that you can slip over your arms. More comfortable in the summer, but it's still not going to be quite as much protection as that leather jacket. Your feet are part of your body. You're going to want to make sure you have a pair of leather boots. These are pretty hardcore. You don't have to go quite that intense, but one thing you want to have is a leather tongue, because if a bead gets on that tongue and it's synthetic, it can burn through. And when you get BBs in your feet, it's not fun. So we're looking at the arc. How are we going to protect ourselves? Well, this is where a welding hood comes in. This is going to be a very easy intro hood to get. It is a passive shade lens. That means that it is, as soon as you flip it down, it's always going to be dark. Another really important part of protecting yourself is when you're grinding, you want to have a grinding shield. This is going to protect yourself from pieces of metal flying up and getting into your eyes. The last piece of our body that we really want to protect is going to be our hands. So we need to get some welding gloves. Depending on the type of welding you're getting into, there's a variety of different ones. So stick welding gloves are going to be thicker, go up a lot higher, be able to handle a lot more heat. If you're going into a MIG, this is going to be a little bit more dexterous, so you can feel that gun as you're gripping it. If you're going into TIG, you're going to have some lightweight gloves so that you can feel the wire as you're feeding it. Let's talk about what you're going to learn, because that's the meat and potatoes of what welding school is. The first thing that any program is going to teach you about is safety. And that is your number one concern while you're welding. Welding can be very hazardous, and you want to make sure that you are protecting yourself the best you can. So different things that you can learn about in safety, they're going to teach you: one, electricity, how to use it safely. Two, you're going to learn about burns, first degree, second degree, third degree, first aid, how to avoid them. You really want to make sure that you know about burns, because unfortunately welding will give you some burns from time to time. You can wear all the protective equipment, and those BBs are very good at finding any kind of way to get in. Another really big part of safety is UV light. Welding, the arc puts off a lot of UV light. You want to be protected from that. When you're welding, you are using shielding gas for MIG, TIG, even stick puts off its own shielding gas. Those shielding gases are inert gases, and what that means is that they displace oxygen. That's what we breathe. If it's pushing it out, that's no good. So you want to make sure you learn about ventilation and what a confined space is. When you need forced ventilation, that is something that you should be learning. You should be learning how to safely use and operate a container of gas. Those containers, if the valve breaks on them, they shoot off like a missile. So you want to learn how to safely set them up, store them, especially when it comes to fuel gases like acetylene. that is a very, very important part to learn how to safely operate those. But another very important part is how the different coatings on metals can be toxic if welded. Say galvanized, if you're welding on galvanized metal, it'll put off fumes. If you breathe those fumes, you get something called metal fever, which makes you feel you have the flu. So you want to learn about all the different coatings and solvents, what they can do, what kind of fumes they can put off, so that you know what you're welding and how to do it safely. Another part of safety is setting up your machine. So your program should teach you how to set up your machine from ground up so that you are properly connecting it. You know where every single lead is supposed to go to. You know how to set up your wire feed system if you're doing MIG. You want to know how to set that up safely, because safety is the number one priority. Another thing that goes along with safety is going to be fire safety. So you should learn about the different types of fire extinguishers and how to use them to properly put out a fire, because that is a thing we are playing with as welders. So depending on the program you're going into, you should learn about different processes, because different processes are good for different things. So if you're going into a stick program, you might be going into construction or pipelining. If you're going into a MIG program, you might be getting into auto body. You might be getting into just fabrication in general. If you're going into TIG, that is going to be more precise work, like working in nuclear plants, a lot of pipe work as well with TIG, or just really delicate welding for stainless, aluminum, lots of different options out there. So talk to the head of the department before you enroll in school to see what things you'd be interested in. There is a website called Careers in Welding. And at that website, you can take a test. It'll tell you different pathways that might be best for you. When I took it, I got fabricator and boilermaker. So those were two things I was really interested in learning more about. Another thing that you're going to be learning about is electrode classification. So when you are doing stick welding, you're using electrodes. When you're MIG welding, you're using wire. When you're TIG welding, you are also using feeder wire and an electrode. There's a lot that you need to know about the things you're using, because they're good for different applications. They run on different polarities. So we got all of this information out of the way. Now it's time to get welding. So most of the time when you are starting off welding, you're going to do something called pad or surface welding, which will look something like this. This is one of my just practice here at the house. Just running bead after bead after bead. What you're going to be shooting for is keeping it consistent, overlapping toe to crown. You want to make sure that you're just getting that technique down. This is also another side. This was with a 6011, just learning how to do that whip and pause, whip and pause, whip and pause. We're going to be going through formative steps, which some people will call a skills ladder, like they did in my program. Depending on what industry you're going into, those skill ladders may be different. But most of the time, you're going to be doing pad welding. So that's position one. And then you might move on to position two, which is horizontal. Position three, after you mastered that one, you're going to start going vertical up. After you get that down, you do position four, overhead. It depends on what kind of program you're going into, but you need to get these formative steps to go along the way. Because, especially if you're going into pipe welding, you get your plate down and all these different steps, it trains you. The pipe is not a flat surface, so you're going to be going in a whole bunch of different positions all at one time, depending on the position of the pipe. So when you're going through school, make sure you really practice. You nail it down. You spend the time that you need to really get good at that position, because the better you get, it's like riding a bike. You'll never forget it. You might have to run it a couple times to pick it up again, but you really want to get the body mechanics down for it. So prepping your material, grinding the mill scale off. If you're doing bevels, you need to learn how to get that bevel degree consistent and learn how to put a land on. These are different things that you're going to be learning for prepping your material, because when you go off to take qualifications for certifications, you'll that's going to be a big part of that as well. Say you're doing a joint, you want to make sure that you're doing a consistent fit up that is not going to be out of whack with high low, where the plates are at different heights after you fit them up. These are all things that you are going to learn. Another big part of welding is cutting. So your school, depending on where you're going, what kind of industry you're going into, you might learn a variety of different ways to cut metal. You might be using an oxy-fuel torch. You might be using a plasma cutter. You might just be using a cutting wheel with your grinder. You're going through these different positions and they need to test to make sure that you do them correctly. Multiple ways of testing, but the main two are destructive or non-destructive testing. Most schools, it's a lot more expensive to do an x-ray than it is to do a bend test. And what a bend test is you cut your coupons out and you bend them to see if you have any imperfections in your weld. These are a couple just examples. This is a face bend, this is a root bend. That's the way we did it at my school. Might be different for yours. Also, if you're doing fillet welds, you might be doing a break test where they break it out and they're going to be looking for the weld, making sure that the weld material didn't break, that it actually tears out your base material. Where am I going to be doing this? You might ask. Well, most schools are going to have what's called a welding booth. So it's going to be a sectioned off area that is just for one person, so you have time to just sit in there and weld until you get it down. You most likely have what's called a fixture table, which is going to be a movable piece for when you're doing the different positions. You might have just a flat table as well for working on your pad welding, but you should have some sort of fixture where you can position the work in different places. Another thing in that welding booth is, depending on the size of them, they might have a forced ventilation if it's just a small enclosed one. They also have UV protection so that if you're walking around outside of the booths, you're not just getting arc flash every time you walk by one. They should have a curtain that is going to absorb that UV ray. If they don't have forced ventilations, maybe they're in a very, very tall building, because that's another thing you'll learn in your safety is when forced ventilation is needed. How am I going to learn all this? How am I going to learn all this? I was right there. Trust me. It's a lot to take in, especially when you're getting into school. It's very overwhelming, but before you even go to school, here's the number one question to ask. How do you do your demonstrations? A demonstration is going to be your instructor showing the entire class how to do each weld. And sometimes they'll be doing it in front of the whole class. They might be showing you a video. They might be coming into your booth and giving you a one-on-one demonstration. So in school, you should be following a welder qualification record or procedure form, which is going to give you hold points for each step of the process. These are things that you're going to be doing out in the real world, so take your test seriously. It is stressful, but that's what part of being a welder is all about. First benefit of going to welding school. Local companies might be in contact with your school already looking for welders. And other companies might come to your school to give presentations on different job opportunities they have for welders. Another thing that you have is a lot of other students in school with you. All of those students might go out to be welders one day, and they might have a job for you after that. Another person that might have a really good idea of where you could go and work is the person that's looking at every single one of your welds. It's your instructor. They have been in the field, they know people, they might have a person that you would be perfect for. So make sure you're utilizing that instructor, asking them questions of where you might fit in best in the welding world. Another good benefit of going to welding school is you get to use someone else's equipment. Welding equipment is expensive. A welding machine, you gotta pay for all your wire, you gotta pay for all your material, you gotta pay for all your gas. There's a lot that comes with welding that adds up really fast. Welding school does cost money to go to, but at the back end of it, you might end up saving a lot more money than trying to learn on your own. I hope that helped answer any questions you might have about welding school. If you have any more questions, feel free to leave a comment down below, and I'll personally reach out and respond to you. Also, make sure you head on over to Weld.com, become a member, because there's tons of forums where you can ask questions and get answers from all kinds of people. So until next time, see you in school.